Well, this GT here with another YouTube video, and today I want to discuss a few things that came to mind based upon the events in the near future and near past and in the present that seem to come together to suggest at least one way in which the so-called New World Order can succeed in its methodology, and that will more or less blackmail everyday people into accepting this new world order based upon their own needs. And the so-called mark of the beast and the image of the beast and the worship of same has been prophesied to be something that will impinge upon our current reality in the near future if it hasn't already. And it is prophesied that there will be a falling away prior to the exposure of the Antichrist or the false Christ or whatever. And this falling away and the acceptance of the mark of the beast, etc., is a willing conscious decision by a large group of people. The falling away is a reduction in the number of people who think and act in such a way that they could be identified or classified as members of God's church. And I'm not talking about a building or a denomination or any organized religious activity or classification, I guess is a good word. So, a falling away. What could happen? What could make this happen? And when we're talking about a large group of people, more than likely, because it's just the wording falling away. It's like an avalanche, or a snowball rolling downhill, or something to that effect. But what I'm trying to get at is that there, maybe the reason behind the falling away, and I believe it's a function of a major deception, worldwide deception. There are many deceptions that we live under every day here in the world, and one of the many deceptions is, at this time and probably for several generations, perhaps more, maybe going back into like the 1850s. a series of deceptions has been in the so-called intellectual world, which prior to, say, the 1850s, it wasn't really a worldwide method of dissemination, and our communication capabilities and those of those powers that be were quite limited. Back in the day, it was a big deal just to get a newspaper or to have a few books. You know, now we take these things quite for granted. I mean, you can go and get a paperback of just about anything that's in paperback for, you know, a used bookstore or whatever, garage sale, they're all over. These things have lost their value, and, you know, back, let's say in the 1800s and such, 19th century, you know, these were things highly prized and valued items. And like I say, we just kind of take them for granted. But the gist of that line of reasoning that I'm trying to get at is that, you know, information was not conveyed or seeded into the world very easily back, very far back. And now it's almost instantaneous with the web and, you know, things like YouTube videos and all such manner of emails, and electronically, you know, we can get information almost, you know, within nanoseconds. And so we, in the modern world, and, you know, and that's not just first world countries and stuff, you know, I mean, they want to make sure that everybody has a television so that they can propagandize you and everywhere. I mean, if you go to the poorest areas of the world, there's going to be some televisions there. You know, there's going to be radios there. People might not hardly be able to afford, you know, food. They'll have a television. You know, the powers that be will make sure that you have one. Now, you know, if you want a little bit more of a discussion about that, see my video on propaganda and, you know, deception, whatever. Not sure the exact name of it right offhand, but, you know, I don't have that many videos to search through. But the thing is that, you know, we as modern humans on the planet Earth are pretty well dependent upon our instantaneous communication and all such things. We need this, or we think we need it, for, you know, as one of the basics of life on Earth nowadays. You know, I mean, in the first world or Western world or whatever you want to call it, we pretty much take a lot of the things in life for granted. I mean, the basics, the staples, the needs, the basic needs of human existence. And these include, and I'm kind of referring back to Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs, because it seems to be applicable in this, you know, in this conversation, or, you know, in that he pictures the hierarchy of needs as a kind of, you know, a triangle, and at the bottom, the base, foundation, you need, you know, people need such basic things of physiological nature, and these include, like, you know, food, water, sex, sleep, homeostasis, such things, you know, clean air, clean water, blah, blah, blah. And I propose to alter that just a little bit in that, you know, okay, those are basic needs, but, you know, when you think about it, when you're talking about physiological comfort and security to a certain degree, so myself, I would include in that category, at least for those of us who are pretty well spoiled with our, you know, first world slash Western world economies and our way of life, is, you know, basic comfort. The ability to have, you know, heat and the winter and air conditioning in the summer, you know. And these are very important things to us. And, you know, having electric lights on and all this. So in terms of the hierarchy, which I mentioned, I think I would also include in those physiological needs, you know, comfort and, you know, a range of the capacity to operate day and night as we do. So, you know, one could add in there energy, you know, and without energy, electricity, gas, etc., our world would be quite different. And I mean, it's going back to the Stone Age. Like, if we didn't have, if the power grid was wiped out right now by a solar flare or an EMP or whatever, we would basically be going back to the Stone Age. You know, and the problem with that is not that, you know, we wouldn't eventually learn how to survive and overcome, adapt to such a thing. Right away, you know, there's going to be a panic. So that's a key thing. And again, let's go back and understand that this basic needs include food and clean water, you know. These also depend upon energy. Right now we have this large dependency upon energy and our energy sources to provide refrigerated transport of food, the electricity powers the pumps that pump our water into our homes for the most part. Some are, you know, semi-gravity based, or you know, you might have a flow if it's from a tower. But you have to pump the water up into the tower. So, you know, right now we're kind of at the mercy of energy in order to secure those basic needs of food and water and comfort in our shelters. And water is needed for our sanitation purposes and our toilets and all that. So there's a lot of things here that are really dependent upon our energy use and the fact that we need our energy. Okay, we depend on our energy for our basic needs to be secured and fulfilled in this Western world. Now, I mean, I'm sure some people out there have wells, and some people have some solar backup stuff and this and that, but for the most part, we don't. And, you know, this is unfortunate, because that means that there's chokehold, strangle point for the New World Order to focus upon in order to deprive us or threaten deprivation, which is the same thing, and control people and their behaviors and what have you. You know, okay. Now, in another way, in shape and form, the energy that we use, and most of it's carbon-based energy from fossil fuels and coal and stuff like that, these things are required to transport our food and to power the tractors and such on the multinational corporate farms that grow most of our food. And so therefore, you know, energy is tightly bound and tied to our needs, our foundation.
It's 10 o'clock.
Of needs. And so we need to understand that main point. Without energy and sources of energy, and I'm talking about energy, electrical, gas, and whatever, most of it is, well, at least here in the United States, is dependent upon some kind of fossil fuel, oil, or, you know, the extraction and processing thereof, and distribution. So, you know, and we really have plenty and all that, and they discover new ways to get more out of less, and how to, you know, extract oil and gas from wells that we thought were empty, or you know, we got the easiest stuff, we skimmed off the cream a long time ago, and now we got just regular old milk. You know, but one has to think, okay, now in the time of the beast and the new world order created by the Antichrist and what have you, who's going to be a false Christ, going to claim to be Christ or the God or God or whatever. There's a falling away prior to and during and after that event or that sequence of events. Now, the falling away has been ongoing, what I alluded to earlier, you know, let's say back in the 1850s. This was the time of, you know, the advent of the Industrial Revolution, a lot of people starting to move away from the farms and going into the cities, and you know, print newspapers and such became, you know, more prevalent and you know, less valued, what have you. I mean, but people were beginning to learn many things. That was kind of, you know, that whole period was an age of going up to Maslow's hierarchy. You know, one of the things at the top is, you know, creativity and problem solving and, you know, learning and growing on an intellectual basis. So, you know, this was kind of like the beginning of the, you know, age of wisdom, and I'll quote unquote that. But the thing is that, you know, people not too much further back in the past never really got past the first few levels of the hierarchy, which, you know, at the bottom is food, shelter, clothing, you know, water, etc., power. You know, back then they didn't, you know, they weren't so dependent on power. But then there's security, you know, and employment, and health, and having property and stuff. And then above that is like friendship and family, and, you know, I don't know, you know, I mean, it doesn't just go like this. It's kind of all really mixed up in there. But I mean, the lower levels are just food, shelter, clothing, you know, peace and security, and the ability to, you know, have a family and whatever. Those things were fairly well secured at that point, and were being empowered and, you know, expanded as the Industrial Revolution went on, and, you know, we became, had higher technology and all that. Well, but the advent of, you know, going into the cities and, you know, the education processes that were set up and all that, you know, to get the public educated, for the most part, you know, only the rich were well educated back in, you know, that period. And, you know, they, a lot of people probably had a good body of knowledge that was available to them through, you know, the school systems and the homeschooling and all that. I'm not saying that they didn't have access to that, but the thing is that, you know, this was a time when information began to be transmitted more rapidly and more timely, and people were not so involved in simply satisfying their basic needs like food and water and all that, you know. As time has gone on, we have become, you know, inundated with all these basic needs, and we don't really even think about them as being a problem, or, you know, we just take it for granted that, you know, we got food and water, you know, and turn on the tap and there it is, you know, water, ooh. You know, don't even think about it. But hey, you know, if you think about it, it's pretty good. You know, most people in the third world, especially, they're still walking, you know, with a bucket or whatever to go get water out of a well or whatever, you know. Same thing goes for food and all that. So, at least for the Western nations, well, let me go back. Now, I was talking about the expansion of knowledge and all that, and how people, you know, this is the time when new ideas became suggested or discovered, or, you know, but these were dispersed more rapidly and more widely, more quickly than in the past. And the agenda of the powers that be, the New World Order, the globalists, and whatever, was, you know, clearly stated to be, you know, get the deception rolling. And it started back then, you know, with a basic group of God-fearing, God-loving, faithful, and I hate to say religious, but maybe that would be apt. Religious or spirituality was pretty widely held in the United States and other countries at this time. Now, you know, in Europe and England and all that, it may be predominantly Catholic and therefore, you know, really sun god worship, but here in the United States, the Protestant Revolution had pretty much settled this country, and this kind of made this country unique and special in that, you know, we as a people were fairly well enlightened with the Protestant spirit and the spirit of God, and this was a good time. Now, the New World Order globalist bastards hated that. You know, oh, we got to do something about this. And so they begin to break down our thoughts and our spirituality through a series of so-called discoveries and intellectual games and deceptions based upon science, you know, which was kind of an upcoming, trendy kind of a thing, you know. And back in the late 1800s and early 1900s, it was probably a big deal to be fairly, you know, well-educated and have intellectual discussions and all this. And they thought that they were, you know, becoming enlightened and all that by, you know, beginning a trend towards humanism. And, you know, this was accomplished via certain so-called theoretical viewpoints and claiming to be or have a scientific basis, such things as evolution, you know. Well, evolution, Darwin and his group, which, you know, if you look up the group or the cohort of Darwin, Galton, and all those, these were globalist bastards who had an agenda. And if you look it up, you will discover, you know, these people are the authors of the deceptions that came in at that time. And the point of evolution was not scientific truth or fact or anything. It was just a theory. It had no proof, still has no proof. None. It's not even a theory, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, it's a conjecture or the musings of a madman. You know, I mean, basically they're saying that life When you get down right down to it, you know, they're suggesting that life just happened. The convergence of, you know, all these millions and trillions of different possibilities congeal in this particular place. It was particularly suited for that particular form of life at that particular time. How? I mean, you say, or they suggest that life just occurred. You know, based on the, you know, convergence of chemical and biological and, you know, environmental factors. Well, I mean, how does that happen? It just can't. I mean, and they take half-truths and they twist things. And they use our mind and our mental capacities to create logical arguments or assumptions or premises that we can accept based on other things. Hey, well, that sounds pretty good, you know. It sounds like it could happen, or yeah, then maybe that's how it is. But the thing is that what they did, that what they, the real basis for doing and expounding this theory and publicizing it and getting accepted, you know, through reasoning and logic, according to them, at a time when most people probably weren't very well educated. I mean, they would have like maybe a third grade education. A lot of people were still illiterate back then, you know, and, you know, just being able to read and write was a big deal, you know. I don't know the extent that illiteracy was, you know, a problem back then, but I mean, we still have basically, you know, functionally illiterate people here in the United States after they get out of the high school, you know. So, yeah, education. Our education system's great, isn't it? Yeah, it's a great propaganda vehicle. And this is, you know, back in the 1800s and 1850-ish, just, you know, out of, you know, a generalized thought process. Yeah, that's when they started disseminating the poison to our mind. Okay, so, you know, eventually when these theories come into widespread acceptance, and, you know, what is the net result? Well, the net result is, and that I believe this is what it was intended to do, was that people began to lose faith in God, and started to believe in, you know, humans, humanism. It's, well, we, you know, we're here, and we, you know, our ancestors were monkeys. Yeah, I mean, okay, we were monkeys, that means what? That means, you know, the Bible, what it says is a lie. It's a lie. We're not created. We're not special. We're not God's children. We're just, you know, blobs of, you know, plasma and bone and whatever. From a scientific viewpoint, we're just a collection of chemicals and whatever that has a value of about, what was it, $2.64 here a while back. Might be more now, but But, you know, so you're no longer one of God's children. You're no longer created by or through or with on the basis of the hand and word of God. And I believe that these poisonings of the mind through so-called intellectual or scientific circles is the etiology and the advent of the falling away. Now, at this time in the present, 2014, I would say that the majority, the grand majority of the brainwashed, publicly schooled people in the United States and probably everywhere in the Western world believe that evolution is a valid and proven theory, which it has never been proven. And there's a video, I believe it's by Trey Smith on YouTube, and something about evolution, 100 questions or something like that. But he goes through and cogently refutes all of the so-called proven or established facts of evolution. And anybody who's really, values intellect and knowledge and such things should see that. Look at that. The truth, is not just our beliefs, okay? If I was a firm believer in evolution, and I know a lot of people are, including many really highly educated individuals, they're not going to change their damn view just because you show them evidence. It's like I told you in a couple other videos, you have to pound this stuff in to change an established view. It doesn't happen. I've got, relatives who think and are starting to awaken, but they're still clinging to those quasi-intellectual beliefs and systems that were programmed into them in their educational, histories. This stuff is pounded in from day one. They're gonna teach evolution, but they're not gonna teach creationism or anything like that because they've got this church state thing. We can't do that. But what they're doing is promoting the anti-God position that we came out of the ooze and we had monkeys for ancestors. Yeah, I mean, when you look at all of the, the statistical and logical aspects of life just occurring out of nothing, I mean, it's just a literal impossibility. And it just doesn't happen. It cannot happen. It doesn't happen. But when you begin, when they get you to start believing or not believing based upon logic and ration and whatever, it's a deception. What is the first thing that happened that screwed us humans way back, according to the Bible? Well, we had Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden living the good life, had no sickness, and you know, nothing evil. There was food all over the place, and they were happy and healthy, and, you know, God walked with them. You know, you're talking about paradise, you know. I mean, that's the good stuff. And, you know, the devil comes up in the form of a serpent or what have you, and I don't know if he was in the form of a serpent, but he was called a serpent, so we'll just accept that as being literal. I don't know, you know, wasn't there. But the thing is, what did he do? You know, he challenged or questioned intellectually the fact that what God said. He said, did he really say that you would, you know, surely die? You will not surely die. You will become like him. You know. So the deception began there. And if you think that he gave up on his deceptive questioning and, you know, trying to get in here, if you think he stopped trying to get into our heads, getting us to question everything about God and having faith, so he broke down the faith and the confidence and the trusting of the female by questioning, you know, well, did he really say that? And then he offered an alternative, which, no, really what's going to happen is, you know, and here we are, he's got an alternative called evolution. And it sounds good, and if you put things together, you know, most of it, or a lot of it, is actually, you know, valid. I mean, what he called evolution, I would call adaptation, and this is built into our genes, you know, based upon the environment, certain epigenetic changes can occur, and or only those who have certain features will survive based upon the characteristics of the environment. And I call that adaptation, but it's really just a genetic predisposition or capacity to overcome the obstacles that present themselves in our environment over time and through changes. You know, if you think about it, wasn't more than, what, 10, 15,000 years ago, you know, there was an ice age, and we lived through that. People maintained life even up in, you know, the northern regions. Toughed it out, adapted, and probably, though, I mean, people who were skinny, for example, and didn't have much body fat, probably didn't survive, you know. So, those genes are still in us, you know, the surviving genes and the gene pool that we have as human beings. And anyway, I know that's a bit of a digression. The fact of the matter is that, you know, we got this deception that has been increasing over time, and it goes from faith in God to faith in humans and faith in science, which is an alternative God, which is really the God of deception and Lucifer, Satan, the devil, whatever. So, over time, these theories and this information, these deceptions, have become totally or widely disseminated and accepted as being the truth. Therefore, you know, a grand majority of people, even though they may go to church and say they believe in God and all that, they believe that evolution is true. So, you know, that's like being lukewarm. I mean, that's the kind of stuff to get you spat out of the mouth of God, because you're mixing the pagan with the Christian, or you're mixing the science with the Christianity, or, you know what I mean? Are you lukewarm? Are you accepting this stuff just because they say that everybody knows that evolution is, you know, do-do-do-do-do-do, blah-blah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah. You know, sucker, you're sitting in a public school and they are spewing this garbage at you 24/7. Yeah, you probably believe it. But if you look at it in a realistic manner, and I, like I said, look at the Trace Met, I believe that's the guy's name. A couple of his videos on evolution and stuff. And, you know, the information that he presents is like, okay, this life out of nothing, ooze or whatever, is totally impossible. You know, and if you want to have an intellectual exercise, try to get the statistics, the statistic probability behind life occurring out of nothing. And if you believe that, then you deserve what you're gonna get. If you're deceived, and you have been, then you need to go and find the truth. That's what I say. Yeah, this video's getting longer and longer, I know, and I'm kind of going off, but the thing is, the age of deception has caused the falling away, and this is my opinion. My opinion is that rather than having a faith in God, we now have a faith in science and a faith in man, although there is no real basis for it, just like in the theory of evolution. There is no proof. There is no way that it can occur. You know, and they want you to believe that crap because they don't want you to have faith, true faith in God. Your mind is trying to tell your heart, no, you know, there's no God, really. I mean, you know, you must be a really weak-minded individual. You believe in God? Really? You must be crazy, you know. No, people. Believing in God is, you know, when you look at the Bible, it says everybody knows there is God. God is here. He has implanted this basic knowledge in our souls. You know, we just know that there is a God, and we have kind of an empty space there, and we're always trying to fill it with something. Usually it's not God. But, so, anyway, these things to which I refer have to do with, you know, education and intellectual pursuits. And these things, let's say in the 1850s, you know, morality, creativity, acceptance of knowledge and learning and all that, these things were not really high up on the list of needs back in the day. What I'm saying is, back then, the people who were these so-called intellectuals and stuff were the powers that be, the rich families, people, the moneyed families. And these are the ones who are the ones who are the puppet masters of the world. And they have conspired, or they have achieved a level of deception upon the public, because they had all their needs taken care of and had nothing else better to do than to, you know, dream up, well, what can we do to screw these people? You know, these commoners, these low-life people who believe in God, you know, we got to take that away from them, because we've got a new God coming in pretty soon. We got to prepare. And the preparation is the falling away of people believing in God. So you understand the process. The process was started by the powers that be, the moneyed people who had the time and the education and, you know, the knowledge to create the deception and promulgate the deception, so that now everybody pretty much accepts all the tenets that they proposed back in the day, even though they never had any proof. So it's just another form of propaganda. You know, if they pounded into you your whole educational life, the whole time you're going to school and all that, you are going to believe it. You're going to fall into the trap, and you have fallen away. You see what I'm saying? Now, going back to the needs, you know, okay. Now, the thing is that you know, I've pretty well established that power or energy is a part of one of those needs. And I'm going back to that. And I'm trying to find out or explore different avenues from which the powers that be can exert a massive control over people and get them to willingly accept their new world, one world religion, and worship the beast or the image of the beast or the name of the beast or whatever, which is the mark of the beast. Okay, and that's what we're going back around to. So, you know, the falling away has to occur, and then, you know, the Antichrist is revealed. And what he has, his system, and, you know, no one can buy or sell unless they have the mark of the beast. Okay, so you don't think about this. The mark of the beast. The mark of the beast is accepting his thoughts, or in thought or in deed, this image of the beast, or worship of the beast, or worship or his name. You know, it goes on and on. It's words, thoughts, deeds that mark you, you know. However, in there is a mark of God also, and it is in your forehead. It's not in your hands, because you can't get to heaven by works. Okay, it's in your head because you think and you believe on God. See what I'm saying? So if you've been deceived by the, you know, scientific and intellectual groups all through your life, is that the mark of the beast? That you no longer believe in God? You believe in man, you believe in science, you believe that life just popped up out of freaking nowhere. Take the leap of faith, you know, that you have to have a faith and a belief in God is not anywhere near as far out as believing that life can just occur out of nothing and that your ancestor is a monkey. If you believe that, you better reevaluate that, because you are an idiot if you believe that. It is statistically so remote. It's impossible. It just cannot happen. And the basis of the evolutionary or Darwinian theories is that life just occurred out of nowhere. We're talking like, you know, I mean, in order to have life, there has to be a plan for life, and it has to be encoded in DNA and all that, and every organism has this stuff. Everything, every cell is a little microcosm of impossibility of just having things happen. Oh, this cell just organized itself into being a free-floating, taking care of itself and homeostatic organism out of nothing. It just happened. And then it combined and altered and mutated into having growing different. You know, it changed. You know, God said he made things after their kind. That means they have a plan. They can't go out of that plan too far. I mean, they can adapt in a certain amount, and within their genetic coding, they have changes that they can do. If you want to be scientific, then be scientific and be smart and apply it. You know, it ain't about having monkeys. You know, damn monkeys. Still got monkeys on Earth. Why would there be any organisms that still maintain the so-called original form? Why haven't they evolved? I mean, this is one of the, like, stupid questions that nobody can answer. Why are they still here if they evolved? Why would one group of species evolve but not the other? And, yeah, it doesn't make any sense. I mean, if you went by their line, there wouldn't be any bacteria. You know, there wouldn't be viruses. There wouldn't be single-celled organisms. They would have already evolved. Why would they stay the same? Yeah. You are an idiot or a really brainwashed individual if you continue to think that evolution is scientifically based or even logical or even reasonable, because it's not. What is reasonable is that we have faith in understanding that there is a God and we were created by him and through him, and that's where we came from. I mean, we can't really understand all the, you know, the complexities of the world and the universe and or even the human body And I know because, you know, I mean, I've been in the universities. I know what we know. And I know the more that I know that we know, the more that I know that we don't know jack about anything. We don't really know. We have a few of the little mechanical and biological, micro, you know, the processes, we can understand them. We don't know how they come together and work. We don't know from a molecular or submolecular basis how anything works. We don't even know how the sun works. I mean, they have theories and they've suggested things, but they don't pan out. You know, this is not a ball of, you know, nuclear fission or whatever. There's just so many things we just can't explain. Because it's beyond our comprehension. And at some point, you just have to accept in your heart, and then in your head, or in your head and your heart, or whatever, you have to just accept that there is a God. You know? And it's... it's not the same God. All these different religions are not the same God. Religion is not God. I'm not going to get into that. But, okay. So far we've kind of gone over some hierarchy of needs and the basis. Energy plays an important part there. And we've gone over the falling away and the deceptions and the lies that have caused the falling away. Now, the falling away has occurred. We, as a human population, have been inundated with the intellectual deception that we are just, you know, creatures of some statistically impossible occurrence called evolution. Okay. So that means we don't really believe in God. Right? I mean, you can't serve God and mammon. You know, which one is it? Are you a believer in God, or are you a believer in evolution? It's that clearly delineated cut line, you know? I mean, it's not just that. It's a bunch of other stuff. But this was the grand deception of the mid-1800s that led to our current understanding or current acceptance, which is basically a falling away. You know, there's people out there, you know, they go to church and they say they believe in God, but in their head, their thinking or their logic or whatever, you ask them, you believe in evolution, they'll say, yeah. Well, if that isn't, you know, a discrepancy or a conflict or cognitive dissonance or whatever you want to call it, I don't know what you call it. I'd call it deceived, and I would call it falling away. And it's a shame because, you know, Lucifer has always appealed to us through our mind and think, well, you sure he said that? Isn't it really this way? You know, God said this, but isn't it really that? You know, we've been lied to and deceived by the best. And, you know, at one time, you know, Lucifer was one of God's favorites. You know, he was really Well, he was really one of the top guy. I mean, he was like the top archangel. You know, he's not a dummy. He knows how to do things. And he knows how to get stupid, gullible people to do what he wants them to do. Like, develop theories of evolution and stuff like that. Well, we are deceived in these ways. You don't think about it, like, probably on a you know, macro level or whatever, but that is what it is, has indeed occurred. Now, okay, let's go on. Now, the basis for this falling away and all that, and what I was trying to get at with the energy and the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, that we all depend upon energy for our basic needs. And right now, I was trying to understand how they come in with this new world order and this one world religion, and people have to willingly sign in or sign up for this and accept it and worship the beast. This cannot be a forced thing. I mean, they can force you, they can say, and they probably will say it sometime, you know, in the you know, eventually they'll probably say, well, you know, you either accept this way and accept the mark, or, you know, we're gonna have to put you out of your misery, you know. And as an aside there, if you look it up, there's evidence that this is probably gonna start here in the United States, because, you know, we have the force and the power militarily to enforce the way of the beast worldwide with our drones and our paramilitary and our super, you know, power status, you know. And it's, you know, hey, if you don't do what we say, we're gonna come over there with our tanks, you know. Look around, what's been happening in the last, you know, since whole last generation was filled full of wars, us going over with our tanks and our planes and stuff. Okay, I don't want to get any further off of that. But the thing is, okay, what are they going to do, these New World Orderists and their, you know, their worship system and whatever? How are they going to get us to willingly accept or sign up or whatever, in effect losing our salvation and cursing us to, you know, death, eternal death, which is, you know, Lucifer's goal, is to take down as many of us as he can get with us, you know, with him, because he knows he's going to lose, right? So he's going to take as many worshipers away from God as he can. That's like, you know, his thing, you know, his goal. What else? He knows he's gonna lose, so what's he gonna do? He's gonna take down as many people with him as he can. Now, how's he gonna do that? He has to get us to sign up for his freaking new world order and worship the beast, take the mark, whatever it may be. It's about worship. And it's, if they can't force you to do it, I mean, technically. So I'm thinking, you know, okay, how are they going to get people to accept this? You know, even people who so-called, you know, are Christians or whatever. How are they going to do that? I mean, it's pretty clear in the Bible, in Revelation and all that, and all throughout the Bible, you know, Ezekiel and the prophecies of Daniel and all, you know, I mean, it's all over, And people who are Christians, Bible reading Christians, and knowledgeable about things in that God has said in His Bible, not the New King James or any of those others, by the way, but you know, the King James Version of the Bible, where the truth is. What I'm trying to get at is, how can these people or this organization, you know, how can they have such a pressure point that, you know, you're going to sign up for this crap? Well, you know, if you go to the basic needs that are at the bottom of the foundation of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you know, food, water, sleep, you know, warmth, security, you know, food, shelter, clothing kind of stuff, basic stuff. Well, you know, okay, we take those for granted here, but what happens if they take and make kind of a chokehold on the basics, okay? And there are, to me, three real basics. I mean, it's food, water, and energy. And as I already discussed, energy has to do with both food and water. So, what is going on in the world? You know? We've got here in the United States, there is this presidential order and all this wild mechanizations and you know, about this carbon poisoning and how we have to, you know, where they're going to start taxing us based upon our energy use, and you know, you global warming is another one of those like ridiculous theories that they're putting out that has no basis, and they even, you know, even the people, you know, it's been debunked, but they're still just going on with it because it's like, you know, we could pound this into your head so many times and whatever the lie, you're going to start believing it and it's just going to be common knowledge. Well, I mean, that's what they did with evolution. You know, global warming, environmentalism, sustainability, blah, blah, blah. Keywords, phrases. But, okay, so right now by presidential edict, Obama is cutting down, shutting down our energy capacity. He's shutting down the coal plants. Okay, right now 50-60% of the United States power comes from this source. I mean, they're shutting down clean coal power that only you know, the only thing that comes out of their stacks is CO2, and they're demonizing CO2 like carbon, you know. Hey, carbon dioxide, yeah, plants need it to live. You know, we need it too, because we need the plants to live so they can give us some oxygen. You know what I'm saying? What's good for the plants is good for the planet. What's good for the plants is good for the humans. Get real. It doesn't take a lot of freaking thought or knowledge or understanding to understand that if you put the CO2 to zero, all the plants are going to die. They breathe CO2. Okay? Duh. Alright. If you're an idiot, or a sucker, or you're so brainwashed, propagandized, that you can't understand simple concepts like that, then you deserve to get your power shut down for some idiot saying global warming, global warming. Oh no, the sky is falling, the sky is falling. You know? God, people. I mean, it's not whether there's global warming, we just need to accept it, you know. Oh my God. You know, it's a propaganda movement, whatever. Okay, I'm going off. And this is getting long. So, okay, now they are shutting down our power. Okay. Now, they have already wiped out the middle class for the most part with their recent cycle of boom bust that they engineered through the banking systems to take your middle class capacity and way of life and all that away from you. What is the goal of the globalists? What is the goal of the New World Order? The New World Order and the goal of these globalist corporate bastards, powers that be, is to make everybody poor except them. They will have all the property, all the resources, and you will be their serfs and their slaves and their fodder for their wars of imperialism and taking over more places that they can take over. Anybody who dares resist, you will be drones for them.
It's 11 o'clock.
And the thing is, the poor population is really just concerned with those lower or most basic of needs on the hierarchy of need: food, shelter, and clothing, and water, and energy for heat and comfort. Those are the real basics. If they can keep us, get us down there, and keep us down there, then they will have a total chokehold, stranglehold, power hold, power center over us, and we will be powerless, literally. You know, unless we do what they say. So going back, you know, and the evolution of this line of thought and the insanity of the world occurrences and like shutting down. Let's shut down all our power plants. What? I mean, who would think of something that stupid? I mean, you don't just, you know, cut your right nut off because your left nut doesn't, you know, seem to like it or whatever. It doesn't get along with it. I mean, what reasoning do they have? It's, they're trying to tell you that your carbon footprint's too big and there's global warming and there's evolution. Yeah, global warming. And so we got to shut down our own power, you know. And the Fukushima debacle has pretty much excluded, you know, building new nuclear power plants. I mean, from a logical point of view, you look at the meltdown over there, it's still not even resolved. Although they're not really, you know, pushing that in the news. The mainstream, lamestream propaganda is not, you know, really going into that. They're just leaving you. Well, we'll forget about it pretty soon. So you know, another news cycle or two, and you'll forget all about that. That never really happened. It's not really a big deal. Like Chernobyl, you know. Not a big deal, you know. Poison in the earth, not a big deal. You know, millions of people died, you know. Sickness, radiation poisoning, the extinction of the Japanese. Not really a big deal. You know, it's not a big deal. Anyway, so proceeding on. Now, they're taking and cutting our power right now. Right? You know, 2014, they're proceeding, you know, our power companies and our power capacity is lowering all the time, and the costs are going up and up. And they've wiped out all industry in the United States to speak of, except for their big mad big farm and, you know, a few, you know, global multinationals like, you know, Walmart and stuff like that, who will end up having control over all the food and all the products that we can buy eventually, you know. And so they're wiping and they're cutting off, you know, our power. Now this goes back to, like, they're lowering our capacity to even have this foundation of food, shelter, clothing, you know, heat, AC, whatever. Obama's over there in Africa saying, you know, you guys can't really have cars and AC and all that, you know, because if we all had it, then it'd ruin the planet. You know, this is another one of those deceptions, you know. Like, there's not enough energy. We have to promote the fact that energy is scarce. And the scarcity of oil and gas is such that we have to go fight over it and take over countries and take theirs, you know. When in reality, the technology has increased in our capacity to extract petroleum and energy resources, and we have a super glut of natural gas here in the United States that we could live efficiently, if, especially if they increase the efficiency of everything using all that stuff. It could last forever, I mean, basically. I mean, no lie. And the reserves are just, like, huge, you know. Down in Texas, they have this huge, huge new reserve. Same thing goes for North Dakota and a bunch of other places. Haven't even tapped, you know, probably 90% of it. Never will have energy scarcity. What we have scarcity of is, like, refineries to process it, because, you know, it'd be a shame if we had lots of refineries and local refineries, because then gas would be really cheap. Gas would be really plentiful. Gas would probably come to be not worth much at all. And the powers that be want to make sure that you pay the fair share, or so-called fair, for your power, you know, your energy. You need to pay lots of money for that, so they keep it artificially scarce. They control it with cartels, the production and the processing and the refining thereof. You know, when's the last time they made a refinery in the United States? Probably back in the 50s or 60s. I don't know, you know, but I know it's been probably a whole generation since we had any new ones, and they won't allow any more. So, is there a conspiracy? Yeah. And if you don't believe that rich and powerful people will conspire to make more money, then you're an idiot. You know. I'm a conspiracy theorist because I know that conspiracies are real, and that the people that have the big money are the ones who are conspiring to screw us, Look at what your freaking president is doing. Look at the fascist, globalist puppets that our so-called representative government is doing to us. Look around. It's not here to help you or to make you safe or to feed you or give you anything but a hard time and decrease your power, take away your rights, and basically screw you at the expense of you. The rich get richer and the poor get poorer and the middle class disappears. Duh. I mean, if you don't know that by looking around, then I don't know what planet you're on, you know. But okay, going back. So they got the energy under, you know, twisting and turning, and they got this so-called global warming environmentalist crap that they're trying to sell you just like they did with evolution. And they're winning because they have the mainstream, lamestream propaganda machine pounding it into your head and pounding it into our kids. They, you know, you don't know how brainwashed those guys are. They actually believe the crap that's been put on them, stuff that we never were taught, and you have no idea what they've been teaching your kids, my kids. All I know is that my kids, as intelligent as they are, you know, are still suckers for programming and brainwashing. And, you know, I think one of my kids or more may even have voted for Obama. You know, you have to be pretty damn deluded, brainwashed, or deceived to believe that clown. Everything he says is a lie. He just tells you what you want to hear, and then he does the exact opposite. Now, the truth is, you know that energy is under fire, is under control, is coming under the purview of the powers that be. Because puppet masters pulled the strings and Obama starts going around everything with his presidential edicts, you know, taking over dictatorial power basically, and nobody's rising up against him in the Congress or anywhere else. I mean, not that we know of, because you don't hear about it, but that doesn't mean it's not happening. I know one thing, you know, people are angry, people are upset, and the people are getting smart, they're waking up, there is an awakening and all that, and this is part of it. I mean, well, I'm trying to help out by connecting a few dots. Okay, so going back, they got the power. They're squeezing the power. Now, so the power's connected to the water and all that. So you're paying more and more for less and less of your power. And you're going to continue, this is going to go more and more, and it's going to, you know, snowball. And it's going to become very expensive just to maintain enough energy, you know, to have lights and refrigeration and all the things that we really need and have and are dependent upon in modern Western society. I mean, we depend on power for our food and our water, as I have said in different things. In addition to the water, being, you know, totally under, pretty much under the control of the powers that be, and the energy being under control of the powers that be, what is happening to our food? Well, I haven't gone into this in any of my other videos, although I have discussed GMOs and stuff like that, but we have, at this point in time, a conspiracy to take over the world's food, the system of seeds, and who has the seeds. And they're even starting to alter the soil and the, you know, the pH of the soil and the quality of and toxicity of the ground that the plants grow in. They are beginning to take over through Monsanto and ADM and Dow and these other chemical companies. We have chemical companies that are in charge of our food supply worldwide. Does that make any sense to you? Why would chemical companies be concerned with food? It makes sense when they are bioengineering and geoengineering and all this kind of crap to take over our food supply. Now, you know, I mean, it was like the mid-90s when they started using the genetic modified organisms that they created and patented into their seeds. And we discover now that, you know, if you have a crop of GMO corn in this field over here, and the guy next to him's got some heirlooms or some non-GMO, then when the wind blows and through the air and whatever, the pollen comes over here into this guy's clean field, and his stuff is GMO'd, genetically altered to that cross-pollination effect to the air. I mean, this can be carried by weather systems and stuff. So, there's going to come a time soon when there is no such thing as, you know, real good God-produced seeds. You know, as in the time of Noah, so it will be in the end. And what was he talking about? He was talking about the corruption of the planet through genetic modifications. Go out there and look it up and think about it and study it, and you'll understand it, that they are genetically altering us, the plants. They're ruining the land and its capacity for regular seeds that are, you know, God made the plants too. They didn't just poof into existence and all of a sudden they're making food, you know, which we just happen to have to eat, you know. They didn't just poof. Wow, there's some wheat. Dude, that is cool. How do you do that? Well, we don't know because God made it. Now, Monsanto is making it. You know, and Dow and ADM and, you know, whatever. They are, you know, they've been using this GMO corn and stuff since the mid-90s. Didn't tell us about it. Like, I just discovered it. Maybe 2011 or so, I don't know, but I was thinking, well, geez, they've already had it out for, you know, a whole generation, almost, well, yeah, about a generation now, at least, or maybe second generation. But the thing is, you know, I mean, they've got studies that went past 3 months, which was the longest study that was ever made on GMO, I believe, that was put out by industry, because, you know, we allowed them to, and the government powers be allowed them to claim that their stuff was basically safe and that it was not significantly different than natural food and seed. Well, you know, hey, the guy in charge used to be in Monsanto, you know, of that particular agency, Alphabet, whatever. I'm not going to go off into that, but okay, so they've got in the works the energy stranglehold. Okay, they've got in the works, and it's been going on for more than a generation, or about a generation, this stranglehold upon our food. And then they've got the chemtrails that I talked about in another video, and how it's poisoning the land, and that they've developed new seeds and such that will allow their genetically engineered seeds and/plants to survive in their toxic ground that they're creating. Okay, in the near future, you know, the collapse of the, you know, with the droughts and all the other changes that are going on, there will be a famine, because they're poisoning the earth, and they're poisoning the plants on the earth with their GMO. Coincidentally, they had the so-called Monsanto Protection Act passed in our Congress from our representatives last year. And it's basically stated that whatever harm Monsanto does in any way, shape, or form, there is no avenue for you to get recompense or to sue them in federal court. This is an unprecedented fascist, corporatist, globalist takeover of the government. I mean, if there was proof, that's it. You know, and that is proof. We have a corporatist, fascist government. To say that you can't be sued for damages that you do as a corporation, who just happens to be in charge of all, you know, the main thing in charge of GMOs worldwide. Now, the Chinese won't even accept that crap into their country. They're turning back shipments. The EU and a lot of other countries have outlawed GMOs. Who does the GMOs? The corporatist, whore, sell-off, fascist bastards in our government, you know. And we used to supply the world with food. Now, take that out and you make it all GMO, which is toxic and cancer producing, potentially gene or DNA altering, and you know, many syndromes, symptoms and sequelae of all kinds have been associated, connected, and proven to be a function of their horrible seeds and their demon seeds. What that is. I mean, you don't go altering things that God made, you know, and not expect there to be some negative consequences. You know, you can't go cloning stuff and making new plants out of combinations of organisms, bacteria, and all that without, you know, maybe pissing off God. He's going to say, "Hey, I made that. What are you doing messing with my stuff?" I would be pissed if I made corn. If I designed it and I made it and I, you know, crafted it, or I was, you know, if I was God and I made corn, in which he did, it didn't go poof, hey, I'm corn, cool dude, all right, corn, you know, food just popped up out of nowhere. You know, evolution also would have to apply to plants, people. So let's, you know, it has nothing to do with it. Okay. Anyway, God made it. He made it the way after their own kind. He made everything the way that they are, and he made them to reproduce through their seeds. Their seeds, not our seeds, not man-made seeds. You know, if I was God right now, I'm just saying, I'm not trying to be blasphemous, but I would be totally pissed if somebody's messing with my creation, you know. And indirectly, they may be messing with human genetic material too, or they may be overtly or covertly doing all kinds of stuff that we don't know about, or that we're not aware of, but I would be pissed. And, you know, going off on the side, if you were killing my people through abortion, I'd be pissed. And the wrath of God, whoa, unto you, when it happens, you know, trumpets blowing, coming up soon. People are going to pay for that stuff. The truth is, the world is corrupted so badly right now, and it will continue to just get worse and worse and more corrupted and more corrupted, that the only way that God's going to be able to clear it back up is to wipe it all out. And he did it once before with water. And this time he's going to use fire to clean it up. Start over again. Look it up if you don't believe me. Look in the Bible. That's where the truth is. King James Version. Okay, so, but the gist of what I'm trying to say is that, you know, soon, if not already, the powers of be have control over our food and our energy. When you have energy, you have power over food and water and their production and their preservation and storage and, you know, everything to do with it, you know, because, I mean, you can't package and distribute and all that food of any kind without energy. Okay, so if the powers that be and the New World Order have a chokehold, stranglehold over our food and our energy, then they have a chokehold energy over you and me. And these are the basic foundations of life that are necessary for us to maintain our lives and our way of life. Now, I'm going to go back to that. How are they going to sign us up or get us to sign up willingly to take the mark of the beast? That's my question. And the ultimate answer is, do you want to eat? Well, how about some food? Do you want to eat? Would you like to have some water pumped to your home? How about some energy for cooking and running your appliances and keeping your house warm in the winter and cool in the summer. Well, you know, unless you sign up with this New World Order and, you know, promise to worship this one God guy that we'd set up, well then, you know, we're gonna have to cut you off. And, you know, you can't buy or sell anything unless you got this mark, according to the biblical prophecies. So if you don't have the mark, then you probably don't have food, water, power. And without the mark, you can't buy or sell, which means you can't pay for your food, your water, or your power. These are the basic needs of the human entity, especially in the first so-called first world, where there's a huge population of people who wouldn't have the foggiest idea how to take care of themselves, or to stay warm or cool, or to feed themselves, if there was some event or some occurrence which caused a steep or a cut or a cut off of power or anything like that. Well, you know, it says in the prophecies of the Revelation also that, you know, there's going to be this famine, but it's going to be about money. You know, so much money for a little bit of this, and so much money for a little bit of that. And it's going to get to the point soon, with the way the trends are, and the way the GMOs are, and the way that the constriction upon the energy resources are, that it is going to become difficult to even pay for the basic needs of the individuals in question, that being human beings on the planet Earth. Do you get it? Do you understand that the chokehold on these systems is what is going to make you sign up for them? You're going to sign on to their world, one world government, and you're going to sign into their one world religion, and you're going to have a mark. Well, let me tell you, folks, you don't want to take the mark. It'd be better for you to be starved to death, or be beheaded, than it will be to take that mark, because then you're going to lose your everlasting life capacity. Once you get that mark, you're doomed to burn, and you ain't coming back. You know, you might come back for the, you know, resurrection prior to the second death. You're gonna die, and you're gonna, you know, you're not gonna exist anymore. You lose your salvation. You lose the grace. You lose the power of the real God, the God that loved us so much that he gave his only son to save us from these globalist bastards who are in charge. Principalities and the rulers. And, you know, I mean, it's about for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. This is talking about the powers that be. The globalist bastards in charge, the banksters, the corporate whores, who are lording over us and holding these things over our heads. There will come a time in the near future when, you know, it will cost more than the average person can afford to pay to get enough food, enough power to get the basics of life. And it's that point, at that point, you or me or whatever, I won't, but many, many people will sign up willingly. Okay, I gotta do this to survive, I gotta do this for my family, blah, 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 blah. You know, not thinking, just like somebody did back in the Garden of Eden. Wasn't thinking. What happened when Eve took the fruit of the tree that she was told not to take of? Will she surely die? No, she didn't die. She didn't die immediately. But she brought death into the human existence. Death. The wages of sin is death. What is this new system coming up? When you sign up for that new system, called the so-called New World Order, the Antichrist, the one world government, one world religion, when you sign up, you take that mark, you signed your own death warrant. You may not die right then, but you're going to die. And you ain't never going to have the capacity for immortal life, for living forever and being with God and Jesus and all the good people who went before you. You will be cursed to death. And you're going to get burned up, and people are going to walk around on your ashes. That's what it says in the Bible. I mean, people will be burned. Ashes. That means burned up. There ain't nothing left. You're not sitting there burning in hell over and over. No, you just die. You get burned up. That's it. The end. You know, that's it. So anyway, we've got a system of people. Over time, you know, we've been deceived. And we are continuing to be deceived with new deceptions every day. There has been a falling away of the beliefs of humans as a whole, and the many series I have gone into, the many deceptions and the alternative religions and the New Age and, you know, the meditations of transcendental people and the transhumanists and all that. A new deception, just new deceptions. Same shit, different day. You know, but there has been a falling away already. People are, yeah, I believe in God and I believe in evolution. Ooh-hoo-hoo. They don't go together. You cannot hold these two thoughts or beliefs. You cannot. You're lukewarm. You're spit from the mouth. There's a falling away already occurred. Now, there's a one world government organizing and capitalizing all the other nations into submission right now. There is a new world system, new world order, one world global government, one world global religion that is being pushed and pressured. And they are choking off our energy, and they are poisoning our food, and they are changing the genetic composition of our food, and they may be changing our genetic composition with that GMO crap. And everything is as it was in the day of Noah. Or it's getting there. Now, now, this has been exceptionally long, but they got your food, your shelter, your power. Now, let's say, just as an example of, you know, extrapolation. Now, let's say that, you know, there's, now barring a financial collapse, which would also effectively do the same thing with the money situation, not us not being able to afford food, shelter, clothing, power, you know, expect the government to come in the case of an economic collapse or hyperinflation or whatever crisis that they decide they're going to come up with. Or, you know, maybe it's just, well, you know, we gotta shut down all this stuff, or, you know, the world is gonna end. You know, we gotta shut down this energy stuff. We gotta cut it off. Sorry, you know, it's gonna cost more and more and more. And when they wiped us all out, the middle class, and they, you know, they got everybody dependent upon them, then they'll say, well, you know, we can provide you the government. You know, the government is going to come up and say, well, we can, you know. And right now they got over 47 million people depending on food stamps. Like, there's your food, you know. And when they cut off the power down to half of what we got now, what do you think power costs are going to be? They're going to be like, you know, that and food are going to be your biggest, like, real expenses. And it's kind of come to the point where people, everyday people, just cannot afford to live. What are you going to do? Especially you poor bastards who are living in them big cities. You know, what are you going to do? Set up a farm in your front yard? Good luck, because, you know, they're spraying chemtrails and poisoning your soil with aluminum and barium and selenium and other toxic metals. Look at my chemtrails video. Check it out. Look it up on YouTube. You know, get your information. But here is a chokehold, a squeeze point, food, shelter, clothing, heat, energy. And they're going to twist it and turn it until you can't afford it. And then you're going to be at their mercy. And you're going to say, mercy, mercy. I want to live, I want to eat, I want to have food, shelter, and clothing. And I want the foundations of basic life. And, you know, if the government or the New World Order says, sign up here and we'll give you food stamps and a, you know, credit on your electricity and this and that, because they own all that stuff. They own it. You don't. You are dependent upon them for everything. What a bunch of foolish sheep we have become. Dependent upon everybody else in the powers that be, one world, new world order system. The corporate bastards and the principalities and the rulers and the darkness and the powers of darkness that are the real puppet masters. Do you get it? Do you understand? This is how they're going to say, hey, sign here on the dotted line and get your mark, and we'll fix you right up. We'll feed you. We'll take care of you. All your needs will be fulfilled. There'll be peace and security, and everything will be just fine. And if you don't like that, then we got some camps over here. We're going to re-educate you and reorient you. And if you still resist, well, then we got some guillotines over here, too. Sounds crazy, don't it? Well, you know, the insanity of the concept of, like, evolution. Yeah, life just happened. It just poof, Everything is genetically and perfectly, it just works. It just happened. That's crazy. That's what's crazy, people. What's crazy is the crap that they're trying to put on you, like, you know, global warming and CO2 is a poison. I hope you're not deceived. And hopefully this video might have helped wake somebody up or to call to action. What I'm trying to get you to do is to look it up, learn about it, think about it, and then share it and care about your fellow man enough. And then wake up, pull your head out of your butt, and go find the source of God. And it's free, and it's easy, and don't cost you nothing, and you get nothing but a lifetime of lifetimes, a forever lifetime. That's a promise. And that's what it says, and I believe it in the Bible. King James Version only. Those other ones have deceptive doctrine and wordings that sound like the same thing, but they ain't now. Anyway, I'm not going to go off on that. What I want to do at this point is just to, you know, go back and say what I said. Okay. As a summary, okay. It's been a falling away. It's been through a series of deceptions over time through our intellectual processes, trying to appeal to logic and reason, and that goes back to the devil and his wily ways of trying to talk, trying to change the truth into whatever he wants it to be for his purposes. Yeah. Okay. There's a chokehold on energy. It's going on right now. There's a chokehold on food. And, you know, energy has to do with food, water, heat, all the basic necessities. Now, these things are very key to understanding. They, as a corporatist, fascist group in the United States and worldwide, are putting a chokehold on the energy and the food that we all need. These things will be used as a pressure point or a series of the pressure points which will get people signed up for their new world order and their one world religious system and all that. And it's all going to make great sense in your head. And it's going to be good for your body because, you know, you have to take care of food and shelter and clothing and heat and cooling and energy needs of all kinds. These things are going to just be good for you in this life. But it's going to damn you to death. It's going to condemn you to death. And it may be, you know, there's going to be a lot of people martyred, beheaded, for Jesus and God's namesake. And they're going to heaven. They'll be there when the new earth is created, you know. Will you? I'm just going to leave you with that thought. So, right now I guess I'm just going to wish you peace, love, power, and I pray a blessing upon all the viewers that you hear the truth, you seek the truth, and then find the truth. God bless you all.